Emma Eckstein was an Austrian writer, and briefly she was a psychoanalyst herself. She was also one of Freud's patients, and through the work they did together, Freud developed what became his theory of seduction. Most of what you can read about Emma is what Freud writes in his project, which was published posthumously, but this is kind of pre-psychoanalysis, this is in the mid-1890s. And when Emma was consulting Freud, she told him about two events from her childhood. In the first event, when she was around 6 years old, she was sexually assaulted in a shop by a man who groped her through her clothes. He smiled as he did so. In the second event, when she was a young teenager, she was laughed at, again in a shop, by a group of young men who made fun of her clothes. After the first event, there was no apparent psychological reaction. But after the second event, which on the face of it is much less traumatic, Emma experiences a range of deeply troubling feelings, and these culminate a phobia, a deep phobia of going into shops. So we must look a bit more closely at these two events or these two scenes. Well, scene one is what we might call the seduction itself. An adult attempts to seduce a child, attempts to assault a child. In fact, does assault a child. Now, there is no reaction from the child, no outward reaction, no arousal in any sense of the word, no conscious trauma. And this initial scene, it may be sexual from the adult's point of view, but it doesn't make sense to call it sexual from the child's point of view, at least not yet. As Freud says in a letter to his colleague Wilhelm Fliess, it is pre-sexually sexual. The second scene occurs later, in puberty. And on the face of it, it's much less violent. It's the kind of seemingly insignificant teasing that could happen to any teenager. But in a crucial article written in 1964, Laplanche and his colleague Jean-Bertrand Pontalis write of this second event, its only power lies in being able to evoke the first event, retroactively, by means of association. It is then the recall of the first scene which sets off the upsurge of sexual excitation, catching the ego in reverse and leaving it disarmed. Now, this idea was soon to be pretty much abandoned by Freud, to be superseded by his theory of infantile sexuality. But this early idea is interesting for two reasons. Firstly, it proposes that sexuality breaks through from outside. It becomes embedded in the subject, almost like a cyst, but without provoking any reaction. And secondly, it proposes that many years later, when the body is sufficiently developed for physical sexuality to emerge, there is something unpleasant about adolescent sexuality, an unpleasantness which lies in this foreign body or cyst, which has been lying dormant and is now ready to break out. And when Freud proposed his theory of seduction, he wanted it to be just that. He wanted it to be a theory which could explain sexuality, not just an empirical observation that assaults and seductions seem to coincide with traumas and subsequently with neurosis. Freud wanted to show, this is what Laplanche says, that it is in the very nature of sexuality to have a traumatic effect. And the theory of seduction intends to show that only a sexual trauma can cause this defence. In other words, that a sexual trauma is a direct cause of the unconscious. And in September, 21st of September 1897, Freud writes again to Wilhelm Fliess, and he confesses that after all he's abandoned his seduction theory. He cannot maintain it, either theoretically or experientially, because if it was true, every neurosis, in fact let's go further, every human unconscious, would be the result of a perverted adult abusing a child. So Freud ditches his seduction theory in favour of, well, in favour of what? Of the Oedipus complex? That's generally how the orthodox story of psychoanalysis is told. The Oedipus complex supersedes the seduction theory. But actually, in his three essays on the theory of sexuality, which was published in 1905, the Oedipus complex is not mentioned. In fact, the essays waver somewhat on the origin and the role of sexuality. But the view that sexuality is endogenous, that is, that it's innate, it originates within the infant and not from outside, predominates the three essays. In the last video, we talked about Copernican revolutions and Ptolemaic retreats. Well, this theory of innate human sexuality is, Laplanche suggests, the Ptolemaic retreat. It's the return to self-centeredness that follows the Copernican discovery of a sexuality that breaks in, intrudes from outside. Laplanche sets about reinventing Freud's theory of seduction. And in doing so, he generalises it. He turns it into a theory of how human sexuality and human subjectivity per se originate.